Hello, and let's talk about another presidential review. We have started the series with that long video about President Bill Clinton. Today we are going to talk about the late great Richard Nixon. Now, Nixon is known to be a president with a very bad past, okay? If you were to look at the president timeline for Nixon, you see that it all leads up to Watergate in 1974, you know, starting in 72. For Richard Nixon, and he is simply a guy who's mired in scandal that ruined what ostensibly happened. But as we see for Mr. Nixon, he has a long, complicated history. Now, Mr. Nixon was exactly what you would think he is, and that is a guy who was very paranoid. A lot of the stereotypes about him are true. He did have a certain past that led to him being this way. And it comes to bear in his presidency. Now, let's start from the beginning. Mr. Nixon was a guy who was born to Christian parents, you know, fringe parents as well, strict ones. He, from a young age, was a guy who needed to work, and ever since he could drive, he would drive to his parents' store and have to work there before school, I mean after school, do more. So this is ostensibly what is doing him in to be a productive member of society. So he does serve in the military as well. He goes in there in 1942. He goes in as a guy who didn't have a lot of money, and he just needed to serve the country, of course, like millions of other white guys did at the time. And he went there, worked on an island, in some irrelevant island in the Pacific. He was a prolific entrepreneur there, given the circumstances. He ran some sort of American food type restaurant in that air base that he was in the Navy, and he made what is about $9,000, which is a lot of money given today's standards. So he went around, and he was able to finally go into the California Congress in 1946. He waged a campaign that was very competitive against the senior Democratic representative Jerry Voorhees. He was able to use his youth, which, you know, he was, I think, 33 at the time, to replace an older guy who was not committed to the district as much as he was. He went house to house. He was doing, you know, small, not even town hall sized events, and he was able to campaign his way with his wife's help to go ahead and get that done. So then he was campaigning a couple times again for that congressional career, and he had done a little bit of stuff that was relevant. He was very anti-communist, and he was known for that Eugene McCarthy type era of anti-Bolshevism. He helped fund the Nixon bill as well, and that was anti-subversive activities. So this was in 1948. That was a major piece of legislation that had to do with his anti-Marxist activities. He also ran for the Senate in 1950. Now, in 1950, California was a red state largely, and he was able to gain that Senate seat. He started running in 1949. He was able to go against Sheridan Downey, but after a primary battle that he thought he would have won, a representative, Helen Douglas, a woman. So she was a weak candidate. She was a woman, of course, so he beat her easily relative to what you would expect, winning, of course, Los Angeles, parts of the Bay, San Diego. So like I said, very red time. It's the opposite of what happened nowadays, really. Canada was a Republican area. Now, he was a progressive Republican at the time, but that was still triangulated to be against what is now the right of today. So, very efficient guy at the time in California politics. Then he goes ahead and he gets selected by Dwight D. Eisenhower to become vice president from 1953 to 61. He was a senator. He did not really get much done, as he was only there for 2 years. But like I said, he was in that Joseph McCarthyan era, and that's mainly his career as an anti-communist. So he played it safe within the Republican confines, as he was not a far-right guy like Robert Taft of the time, or relatively left like Ike. Okay, so he was picked because he was seen as a national youth figure for the Republicans. He was, I believe, 39 at the time, and he was able to communicate that youth to be respected, and he was the center of the Republican Party, like I said, not on either extremes of the party, and that would help balance out the ticket when you include Ike Eisenhower as a guy who was on the left spectrum, as he had popularized that no Republican will be elected going against the New Deal, which is exactly what he did. Eisenhower was able to wield the government to what he needed to do, and so that's what got him elected to begin with and reelected. Now, as vice president, he was able to very importantly do foreign liaison trips to Southeast Asia, to places like Malaysia, Indonesia, and other places like that that would solidify his relationships with the dictators of the time. And then when the time came for him to be president, he would already have relationships. So to put this in perspective, if you were to meet a big time second-rate politician in Laos in 1960, 8 years time, that could have been the prime minister that he had already met when in a time when they were less relevant. So it would ingratiate him with foreign leaders. Very important to the whole Henry Kissinger type diplomacy. Now, after this ticket to become vice president, he was able to ingratiate himself with Ike. His relationship with Ike Eisenhower was severe enough to where they were able to marry off their kids to each other. So very important relationship building within the Republican Party itself. The dynamic between Dick and Ike was special, as Ike Eisenhower was personally very approved of, even though the party was fractured under him. And he had the resentment, similar to George H.W. Bush, of the far right and the paleoconservatives like Pat Buchanan in the 90s, and especially, of course, Robert Taft of Ohio, the senator there in the 50s and 60s. Eisenhower was a guy who cared about his popularity before anybody else, so he wasn't willing to risk his own person to help salvage a career politically speaking, and he wouldn't do endorsements very often, nor would he campaign for other people during midterm elections. So a lot of this handiwork came down to Nixon. Now, by giving Nixon the leverage to do such a thing, it looked like he was a runt boy, but what Nixon understood in this was that he was able to forge relationships with senators under the presidency of Eisenhower, and under that pretext to solidify relationships with people that in 8 years' time would have become very useful to him as political tools. Very important to note. Mr. Nixon was able to go to Africa, and he was also shepherding the Civil Rights Act in 1957. This was also the time in which Eisenhower was desegregating and forcing Negroes to go into white schools, and this goes to solidify Nixon's bona fides in terms of being a progressive Republican. So it takes away the argument that he was racist, which helps in getting independent white support in the South, perhaps, and it's a big part of the Nixon strategy. So when you go to the 1960 election, he goes against, of course, John F. Kennedy, and he narrowly loses. We're talking a 0.2% difference, really, 100,000 vote difference. Now, Nixon really suffered in this, in that this is an unprecedented time for debates, and these presidential debates at the time showed that while they were both the same age, it would seem that John F. Kennedy, his contemporary in the Congress, is both freshmen in 1946, were both, was he not also maybe more articulate in his voice, but he was also more prepared to become a stageling, and, you know, his relative telegenic looks for the cameras, what may have put him over the top. But not only that, but there were also cases of voter fraud in Texas in which he was able to win by about 2%, and in Illinois where he won by less than 1% too. Now, this would have been very critical in terms of winning the election for Nixon. as these were 45 electoral votes, which were close to getting him in a decisive way to win. And if we were to remember history, Mayor Daley of Illinois, of Chicago, was a strong supporter of the Kennedys and was ingratiated with the mob aspect. So voter fraud and suppression must have happened there. So in reality, if you were to take those into account, perhaps Nixon should have been president. Okay, and so this phenomenon is very important as he, off the momentum of vice president, loses it all because he eventually lost, and narrowly so, and this really crushed the morale of Richard Nixon. Nixon went back to California and he was encouraged to run for governor of Cali in 1962. And he did enter the race, but after a while, meaning that he did lose the state election. Also, he was suspected of doing this as a ploy, as a stepping stone to become president later in 1964. So, very important to note that this whole political climbing, this ladder, is it's a cardinal rule to follow that if somebody's running for an election, expect them to leave to go to Washington. So, of course, this tormented Nixon, who may have not even wanted to be president at the time, but clearly it screwed him over there in that election. So he lost by about 5%, and that was believed to kill his career at the time. So in 63, the Nixons moved to Europe, where he met with leaders again and ingratiated himself with those leaders he had already met before. And he had also pledged not to run in 1964 after Kennedy died, and he supported Senator Barry Goldwater to become the nominee. And Barry Goldwater politically transformed the party, and he was a French candidate who won a plurality, not a majority, of the Republican electorate in the 1964 primary, so that he was able to ostensibly fragment the party enough to lose widely to Lyndon Baines Johnson. So this was an opportunity to step away to say that Nixon was saying that this guy is not worthy, but he took the risk because Nixon had nothing else better to do. So since his political career was fledgling, he needed to leverage his clout as former vice president and try to help Barry Goldwater and try to retain as much of the Congress and of the Senate that he possibly could for the Republicans, yet again showing that he is establishing political concrete around these people in the bicameral system of the United States that he later uses as puppets for the 1960s and 70s when he's president. During the election of 68, he was able to run again, and though his wife may have not have wanted it, he still went ahead with this. And the Tet Offensive very much influenced this. It hurt the Democrats as Lyndon Jane Baines Johnson doubled down on the Vietnam War. By doubling down on the Vietnam War, the far left of the party were personally against it. So when Robert F. Kennedy decided to jump in for the second term contest of the Democrats in control of the White House, he did get assassinated as he was picking up steam, though, after New Hampshire and after winning in California in that primary. And on the Republican side, his opposition was from George Romney, who was a draft pick from the Republicans trying to screw him over, and also Nelson Rockefeller, a moderate conservative from New York, and a firebrand conservative, Ronald Reagan, both jumped in to try to be nominated at a brokered type of shadowy convention on the but Nixon was able to secure the nomination on the first ballot, and he elected Governor Spiro Agnew of Maryland. Maryland being not important of a state, but also he did want a southerner that was mid-Atlantic, so this was an electoral choice for 1968. And he knew that Spiro Agnew had a good enough record, and of course, you need to make sure that your VP pick is compatible. Also, by him being VP for 2 terms, he knows exactly what it is to be signing up for that job, so he made sure that Agnew wouldn't want to go back. This ultimately bit him in the behind because that obviously didn't work out. So he did this to unite the party, to appease northern moderates and southerners disaffected by the Democrats that were going far left. Nixon's Democratic opponent in this general election was Herbert Humphrey, who was the vice president of Lyndon Johnson. And he was nominated at the convention, even though other leftists didn't want another acolyte of the war crowd to become the nominee. Nixon was trying to look at the stability factor, as he was the VP during a stable presidency in Eisenhower's tenure. So hypothetically, it would be good for him to take that tide well within the context of him not starting any wars in that administration. So it would go antithetical as an implication against the pro-war crowd in the Democratic Party, which was championed by Herbert Humphrey at the time. This helped him triangulate with independents, and the far left did not turn out for Humphrey. He went against the silent, he was pro-silent majority of the socially conservative Americans that were reactionary against the hippie counterculture and the anti-war protesters, because Nixon was pro-war, tacitly so. And he went along with a television advertising campaign, and he was finally embracing the stage light, and he was promising peace with honor in the Vietnam War and trying to fundamentally change the operations, but also keeping vaguely what Lyndon had been doing before. In the three-way race between Nixon, Humphrey, and the segregationist George Wallace, Nixon beat Humphrey by about 500,000 votes, which is less than 1% of the vote, and with 301 electoral votes to 191 for Humphrey and 46 for Wallace. Nixon was able to barely win because of the fractured Democratic Party that was disaffected with the segregationist and the pro-civil rights factions of the parties. Richard Nixon was inaugurated as president in 1969, and he was finally able to win what he had sought for 8 years past. He, in foreign diplomacy, was important because he picked this Jew named Henry Kissinger, who was relatively young, to create this concept of a peaceful decline, and that is that America was declining in relative power, and that they would manage to decline by not going to war with China, but opening them up before there was an antagonizing relationship there. So in relations to China, Nixon laid the groundwork for this by opening them up and visiting Chairman Mao, and by visiting Zhou Enlai, the Chinese premier, he was able to open them up to further trade. By opening them up to trade, it opened up the free market capitalism that China knows today, and it also exploited their economy, and it helped with trade, basically, with America in the meantime. And this whole concept of foreign diplomacy was very, very high IQ, as the Americans were seeking an administration that would push the Chinese and wedge them between the Soviets, as both the Chinese and the Soviets were allies against the Americans because of them being both communist. But he drew a wedge between the Maoist communist tradition and tried to make them join Western markets instead of being dependent on themselves and the Soviets. So by weakening the communist bloc, Nixon was effectively able to help neuter the Soviet Union in their attempts at winning the Cold War. He also did this with foreign diplomacy with Pakistan. Nixon knew that China was using Pakistan against India because China and India are mortal enemies. So by exploiting the old grudge between Pakistan and India, the Nixons were helping facilitate a sort of triangulation in the power groups in the region. So he basically egged on the Soviets in helping India against Pakistan, helped by China. So by having a proxy war scenario go forth, and using strategy to pit his enemies against each other, he was effectively able to avoid a war for the 5 years of his presidency. So this was a big foreign diplomacy win. And then with the Vietnam War, he was able to basically flounder around and bleed the communist forces dry. But of course, they did not run out of manpower yet, and a drawn-out war would have been too expensive, and he ostensibly kept on pulling out troops until it was too late, and there was a big offensive that drew people out. But this did not completely finish until after the negotiation treaties with the President Gerald Ford. So it was a complete loss what happened in Vietnam. at best, what he did was he mitigated a bigger disaster, but overall, he didn't get anything done, and he picked the wrong person to become Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara. This guy was a computational mechanical engineer, I believe, who knew that, okay, well, we're killing so-and-so and so-many-so casualties and so forth, but does this not... This approach, this cold, calculated approach, did not work with the American people, so it hurt his approval at various points in the presidency. There was the Latin American policy, which was very particular, as he had been a firm supporter of Kennedy's choice of going through with the Bay of Pigs invasion. That didn't work out, and he was screwed from the start because already the relationships with the Cubans were strained because Kennedy had really messed up that invasion, and also Kennedy screwed up the Laos pullout of troops, the logistical Ho Chi Minh Trail that helped keep the North surviving with Chinese logistical support and weaponry was only enabled because Kennedy was pulling out the troops and really screwing up the military situation in Asia and in Latin America. So Nixon had to salvage this by fighting all communistic forces, and he did believe in domino theory, thinking that if one country became communist, they would try to spread the revolution as Trotsky had envisioned. So the election of the Marxist candidate Salvador Allende as president of Chile in 1970 got Nixon and Kissinger to pursue a vigorous campaign of trying to kill Allende and trying to depose of him. So they tried to get him deposed that no matter what. So they got the general Augusto Pinochet to do a coup d'etat in September 11th of 1973 with help of the CIA to kill Allende and take over as a military junta dictatorship. They embraced free market capitalism, and this helped the Western movement, even though it was a corrupt way of doing things. But Nixon supported these unconventional means to do whatever he wanted and sought to be the best idea. With the Soviet Union in particular, he wanted to de-escalate, and he did promote the anti-ballistic missile treaty, which was very important as he wanted to lower the risk of Soviet destruction and mutually assured destruction in the totals. He also tried to promote the U.S. World Fair, or just the World Fair period, and that is a sort of event that shows off the best appliances and sort of factoids and culture of different countries. So he did this as a propaganda, as the Soviets had closed borders largely, so they did not interact with the Western countries. And so when he did walks with the leader Brezhnev and other Soviets, he showed them how Americans lived, how the American middle class home was like. And he was basically able to endorse a sort of lifestyle that was showing off to the Soviets. He also introduced certain sodas to the Soviet Union. So it was all a ploy to subvert their communism. In terms of the Middle East, the Nixon Doctrine was supposed to mitigate disasters. He wanted to help Israel, so he helped pull out of it was an aftershock of the Eisenhower administration's U.S. crisis, and he also had to mitigate the oil crisis going on, and this all had to do with the leader of Egypt. His name was Anwar Sadat, and he also had to deal with Nasser, of course. And because of Israel's victory and him bailing out Israel in that Yom Kippur War, there was a OPEC nation cartel that ostensibly refused to sell oil to the U.S., which resulted in the 1973 oil crisis. This initiated the stagflation, which hurt the economy very badly. So he completely screwed that one up. If anything, he should have let Israel die on its own and then had OPEC keep on selling it oil, because America was not nearly close enough to being energy independent at that point. So by relying on Middle Eastern oil, they were able to leverage what he did as supporting the Israelis in a time of need, and that ended up screwing over the American economy, which hurt his re-election prospects in the long term, or his legacy, sorry. So in terms of domestic policy, Nixon took office when the inflation was at 4.7%, which was the highest rate since the Korean War, and due to the Great Society legislation by Lyndon Baines Johnson and the Vietnam War costs, there was a huge budget deficit at the time. Unemployment was still low, but the interest rates were really high, And Nixon's major economic goal was to reduce the inflation, which meant ending the war so that there wouldn't be military production that was unnecessary, which was inflating the economy. So that's why he slowly pulled out of Vietnam. And also because Nixon had a lackluster performance in the midterm elections in 1970, and the Democrats controlled both chambers of the Congress, he was able to not do as much as he wanted. So Nixon was the first president to let women take credit, and by letting women take credit cards, the credit card debt tripled very quickly. He also did try to dampen inflation by doing the Nixon shock. The Nixon shock being what was capping prices and doing a lot of communistic type economic moves like freezing wages for 90 days. And this did lower inflation, but not exactly what he wanted them to be. And there was after the day after he imposed the price controls in 1973, he did get a huge rally in the stock market, but it went right back down as the economic effects of having the command economy did not work out to his benefit. But he did dampen inflation through 1972 during the election year, and GDP was up 7%, I believe. So it was very impressive what he did there with the price controls. But after re-election, the inflation came back, and this really became unpopular as the price controls were not seen as good by labor unions, and so they wanted higher wages. So this hurt his approval ratings dramatically, which limited his effectiveness in Washington already with a bicameral majority by the Democrats. Now, Nixon adopted a sort of new federalism project, which was to eliminate cabinet level positions that were seen as useless, and he also wanted the EPA to occur. He did go for more liberal, progressive things that were politically expedient at the time, like the Clean Air Act of 1970, the Clean Water Act of 1972, and he wanted to reform health insurance by having a mandate on private insurers and private employers, sorry, and he wanted to federalize Medicaid for poor family with dependent minor children. He promoted kidney care. He got that done. He wanted to invest more money on sickle cell research, which mostly affected blacks. And he wanted to wage a war on cancer. And he also was contradicting because he did want to reduce spending in other places. But overall, he was doing whatever was politically expedient at the time. And so if there was a big hippie movement to do something, he usually acquiesced. Which is why you got all these little token, little EPA sort of Clean Water Act type things. Okay, now you look at civil rights. With civil rights, he wanted, well, he did not necessarily want, but he was able to get first large scale integration of public schools in the southern states. And this was antithetical to the segregational Wallace Coalition. And he did lose a lot of support by maybe some far left people, or sorry, very conservative Democrats, as they were being forced to have Negroes in their school. This hurt his approval ratings even more with certain people, but raised it with others. Nixon failed at doing whatever he wanted to do with NASA because of the Apollo 11 worked, but I don't believe that it was necessarily what needed to be done. As you know, after we got to the moon, Nixon just stopped investing in the NASA project as nothing really happened. And he did approve a 5-year cooperative program in 19, well, culminating in 1975 with the joint Apollo and Soyuz spacecraft linking in space. So this was another diplomatic type move or gesture, but really didn't get much done there. In terms of the 1972 presidential campaign, this was a time of political realignment. The Solid South had been a source of frustration, as Goldwater did win several of the southern states by merely opposing the Civil Rights Act in 1964, but he did alienate the moderates in the South. So Nixon tried to get the moderate support by getting former George Wallace supporters, and through his first term, he wanted the Southern Strategy to work with desegregation plans that would try to be courteous to the white people in the South and to be palatable to everybody. Now, this did largely work, really, and when he virtually completely assured the the Republican nomination in 1972, he had already expected his competitor to be Massachusetts Senator Edward Kennedy, but he was removed from contention because of Chappaquiddick, where he killed this girl. So instead, he went against Edmund Muskie. And then George McGovern was also behind his trail in 1972 in the Democratic primary. But after McGovern won the California primary, he secured the Democratic nomination. And so when Nixon was at the Republican National Convention, he dismissed the Democratic platform as being cowardly and divisive. And McGovern also went against the establishment by wanting to decrease federal defense spending and was very anti the Vietnam War. He supported amnesty for draft evaders, which what Jimmy Carter got done later on. He got rid of the abortion rights. I mean, wanted more abortion rights. And he wanted more drug legalization, or at least he was wanting to he was drawn as doing that. So basically what was happening with this Democratic platform was that Nixon was exploiting the relative weakness. Like I said, Missouri Senator Thomas Eagleton was dumped from the Democrats' ticket because he had been getting lobotomized, I believe, for having depression. And Nixon was going ahead in most polls, so when he wanted to get another VP, the next VP for McGovern was to be Sergeant Shriver, which is an associate of the Kennedy family. He won and beat McGovern with over 60% of the popular vote, only losing Massachusetts and Washington, D.C. So a complete landslide for Nixon, but this was all temporary. Now let's go into the Watergate case. Watergate was interesting. No, it wasn't. I'm kidding. It was basically where Nixon, in his paranoia, tried to, or at the very least, his associates broke into the Watergate Hotel to investigate the Democrats, and they were trying to get one up on him, and he basically made a Faustian pact with the devil insofar as Nixon was getting dark money and he was doing whatever he needed to guarantee the election. He didn't need any of this to win, but he still was insecure, and so he went along with this. And by having a taping system in the White House, he was able to self-incriminate himself. So that bit him in the butt too. And then this led to his resignation. In his resignation speech, he basically admitted to most things, but of course he did leave things to be settled by his vice president, Gerald Ford, his pick from 1972. If you were to remember, he dumped Spiro Agnew because Spiro Agnew got tired of being useless in the White House and wanted to be more relevant in Maryland again, as he was governor before the vice presidency. So Nixon was succeeded, of course, and it was all good from there. No, well, he did get pardoned, and by getting pardoned, his career was salvaged so far as he went back to public life and did not have to be trudged through the mud politically. He was going to get impeached, and he was more poised to be removed than any other president at this time, at least in over 100 years. His approval rating, of course, shot to the ground, and it was bad. So, what was I talking about? Okay, so Nixon did overall survive Watergate with his career completely decimated, like Bill Clinton had with Monica Lewinsky in my other video I had noted. So, he did die an old man. He did die somewhat rectified in history, as he was pretty popular with Ronald Reagan and other more popular people in general, but it would seem as if this guy was not a completely good faith actor. Events in his presidency made him paranoid, because for a good reason. He knew that he had sinned against the people that counted on him. So, of course, Richard Nixon was disappointing in effect, and it is supposed to be necessarily looked down upon what he did in Watergate and how he sold out to people. But Nixon was to be seen as a certain guy that did innovate a lot, but he did also introduce a lot of neoliberalism to the Republican Party. He had Henry Kissinger be an important role for several years, even in the capacity in Gerald R. Ford's administration. His legacy is tainted by the fact that he did also do a lot of progressive things, and he did not fundamentally cut on the deficits enabled by the Great Society. He did not really stop any of that. He also completely bundled up that whole, he completely screwed up that Israeli war. He really shouldn't have helped Israel when we were so vulnerable as a country. A decade of, or about several years of economic piss poor, optics and, you know, energy independence were dampened because of him, and he was able to ostensibly avoid a lot of these economic problems for the longest time until it bit Ford in the ass and a bit Carter in the ass too. So I do think that he was a dishonest person, because he did, you know, I read his autobiography and he blames everybody but himself. Okay, so to wrap this video up, I do think that Nixon was a fundamentally dishonest person, like a lot of politicians were. He likes to blame other people, and that ultimately led him to be scared of everybody because he knew he was lying to himself. Now, he did do a lot of great things in terms of the economy. He did do some great foreign diplomacy. I do see him as a relatively good president overall, and he was very politically savvy and smart. So I would say that he is a, I don't know, I'd put him at a, maybe a 5 or a 6 in terms of a president personally. So thank you guys for watching this presidential review.